So for a long time, historians of science have been interested in the phenomenon of empire and the relationship between empire building and scientific knowledge production. It's been clear that empires were crucial to the making of modern science, and vice versa, that modern science has been a key force in propping up, legitimating imperialism. But most of those studies have paid attention to the British and French empires, to overseas imperialism. And the phenomenon of continental imperialism, or sometimes called internal colonization, has received much less attention from historians of science. And so that is first and foremost why I find the Austrian Empire of the 19th century a particularly fertile ground for pursuing history of science. There are relationships between this political structure and the structure of the modern sciences that have very much yet to be teased out. And so in my first book, I was interested in the relationship between political liberalism and developments in the sciences that were tolerant or even enthusiastic about the recognition of a fundamental quality of uncertainty in nature. And in my most recent book, I have been interested more in the infrastructure for doing science and governing empire in the Habsburg monarchy, and the relationship between a state that operated at multiple scales and a science that pursued the multi-scalar qualities of atmospheric phenomena. If we turn back to the early 19th century, circa 1800, the study of climate was bifurcated. On the one hand, there were a few people who were theorizing about the physical basis for the Earth's atmospheric circulation on a planetary scale. On the other hand, there were more and more explorers, scientific explorers, or medical researchers, agricultural researchers, who were collecting very fine-grained information about the variability of climate across the surface of the Earth. And there was no way, as yet, to put those pieces of the puzzle together, right? To understand the relationship between those planetary-scale forces that drove the atmospheric circulation as a whole and the microclimates, right, that were being mapped throughout Europe and beyond as empires were spreading, right? So I'm interested in how the pieces of the puzzle were put together, right? How those scales were bridged, and not just spatial scales, but also temporal scales, because there was a similar tension in the early 19th century between growing evidence of massive climate change on a geological time scale, on the one hand, and the apparent stability of climate on the human scale. Although that too was in question, whether or not climate could change over the span of a human lifetime was a question that exercised a lot of people at the time, right? But there was no way, as of yet, to connect up the evidence for climate variability over the history of the planet as a whole and the as yet weak evidence for climate variability due to human activities like cutting down forests, draining swamps, building cities. So we have a planetary scale science of climate and we have local studies of climate, right? And so my book is really Climate in Motion is really about the effort to put these together. And I call the science that accomplished that dynamic climatology, right? And dynamic climatology, I would without any hesitation, identify as modern climate science because it was multiscalar, precisely because it managed to work across these dimensions of space and time. That to me seems like a hallmark of modernity, being able to put the local and even the personal, right, into some kind of appropriate proportion with the impersonal, the global, right, the planetary. Yeah, you know, today citizen science is a very funny term. It's used to mean so many different things. So sometimes it's used to mean programs where citizens are going out into their backyards and looking around more carefully than they would usually do, and keeping track of phenomena like bird migrations or the timing of the flowering of plants or water levels, right? And so I see a lot of parallels between that kind of work and the 19th century reliance on non-scientists for environmental information. And I think in both cases, there's a real benefit not just to the science, right? I mean, yes, this is the only way we have to gather that kind of fine-grained information on environmental change, right? Our satellites, our monitors are not going to provide that level of detail. But at the same time, I think there's a huge benefit for environmental consciousness, right? For a widespread attention to what matters, right, in the non-human world, to the vulnerability of the non-human world, to simply keeping track of of the degree of instability, right? At the same time, there are many other activities that go under the name of citizen science these days, which include things like using your computer when it's idle to do calculations that benefit some scientific laboratory very far away, or playing a video game, right, that simulates folding proteins in order to help biologists, also very far away, right? And I think those kinds of abstract forms of engagement with science may serve some of the purposes that scientists today attach to citizen science. They may do the work of public communication, public engagement, right? They may seem, at least, to build support for scientific research. And I think that is important. I think we do need to let the public know that basic research matters. But I'm a little skeptical of calling that citizen science because I don't really see the citizens as participants in the research. I see it as kind of a dumbed down version of research that they're engaging in. So I would really love to see the expansion of those citizen science programs that are really letting non-scientists get their hands dirty, producing information that is really going to feed back into the models, the predictions that the scientists are making about environmental change, right? And that really becomes a two-way street. I think that's the ultimate value of this kind of participatory research, is that the science, the scientists begin to ask new questions, right? Because they have the public asking questions of them. And it becomes so there was a metaphor that an early 20th century philosopher of science used that I think is just beautiful, that science is like a river, and the riverbed is constantly changing, right? That is the public, right? The riverbed is constantly in flux and shaping the course of the river. So I think we need to think about science and its public as a system, hydrological system like that that's changing together.